Well, they've got a lighting show that's set up goalposts as well as that ball next to the Eiffel Tower. Massive crowd around the Trocadero, and look at the crowd at Stade de France. After tonight, one of these teams will tie Australia for the most appearances in a Rugby World Cup final. That's three, incidentally. The French have been there in 87 and 99, England in 91 and 03. There is the England lineup, and here is their coach, Brian Ashton.
It's going to be a massive occasion for everyone concerned, I think. You know, we fully understand the difficulty of the event and the challenge that we're going to face, but yeah, we're ready for it tonight. I've never seen an England team as ready as these guys are tonight.
Well, the French have made the semi-finals of every Rugby World Cup except 1991, when England beat them in the quarter-finals. And here is their defensive coach, Dave Ellis.
It's always key is defence. If you don't defend well, then you get punished, especially by top teams like England. But there's lots of other factors that go into it, particularly like last week, there was the kicking, the chasing, and many other aspects of the game.
Bernard Lepore has not given English-speaking interviews so far. Here's the toss. Rafael Ibanez, Phil Vickery.
That's a tackle or pulse? Tackle or pulse? Tackle? Pulse? Your choice. Kick-off? Kick-off? Do you know which side you want?
Okay, Phil Vickery not really caring which way he runs, of course, having lost the toss. Stade de France has hosted five Rugby World Cup matches, including two quarterfinals in 1990 and 2007, but never a Rugby World Cup semi-final. Your commentators, Rupert McCall, Ben Darwin and Ben Tune.
Thanks, Bill. They eyed each other off at the toss, the two skippers, Phil Vickery and Rafael Ibanez. They will eye each other off in the scrum all night. Welcome to Le Crunch. That's the way this game's been billed in the press this week. It means the same in French as it does in English. This is a crunch match between two magnificent rivals. They've played each other this, the 90th time in rugby history, and none as important as this match for a spot in the Rugby World Cup final. Ben Tune, Ben Darwin.
Thanks, Rupert. High stakes rugby, you're right, does not get any bigger than this. Both teams had massive quarterfinal games. Both teams would have been emotionally, physically and mentally drained from those quarterfinals. I think the team that can bounce back from that and be able to, I guess, lift it up even another level for this semi-final match will win this game.
Well, if we do want to talk tactics just a tiny bit, I think if you can shut down Sheridan and you can shut down Wilkinson, then you can beat England. I think that's what France will be targeting to do. I don't think they'll go for the dirty tactics. 99, I think, showed that probably isn't the way for them in big crunch matches, because it takes the focus off them playing the right type of way.
And they don't need to anymore, I think. I think they're a good enough side to win this purely on talent.
Andrew Sheridan, the beast from Bromley, monstered the Australian pack last week. But Peter Tafilias and Olivia Miu will be waiting. And waiting with a great sense of anticipation, as we are, Johnny Wilkinson and Matthew Tate.
The Tai Chi.
The blonde-haired assassin there, Crazy Horse, as he's affectionately known, Lewis Moody, looking to get to every breakdown. Serge Betts in the beer, it's Bomber on the other side of the ledger.
It is amazing how quickly Wilkinson's been able to hit form, given the amount of injuries he's had. Here he is back in the tournament and hitting his straps, but his kicking hasn't quite been on song from the mark between the posts.
You're absolutely right, Ben Darwin. At the moment, he's averaging 63%. He's normally up over 80%. He's complained about the balls for the first... Well, he complained he hasn't been able to practice with the balls that he plays with. This week, he got to practice with six of the match balls, so he's a happy boy. Let's see if it translates into a better kicking game from him.
The French, under the guidance of Bernard Laporte, prepare to take the field of battle, and it might come down to a kick. This match will hinge on something special, possibly spectacular. A new page in rugby history will be written. Both sides were beaten in the pool stages. The French on night one to Argentina. The English 36-0 to South Africa. They are the other sides in semi-final contention at Stade de France tomorrow night, but for now, it is France and it is England, and it is going to be big.
I was quite surprised by Phil Vickery getting back into the starting team. Stevens, I actually feel, is a better prop, but Vickery's leadership really told against the Australians last week. He was extremely emotional after the game, and it's interesting to see Vickery actually isn't leading the team out, but he is captain for tonight's game.
You can see Jason Robinson leading his English side out. He plays his 50th Test match tonight. Many thought he wouldn't get to play another one. He wouldn't reach the 50 milestone after tearing his hamstring against South Africa.
Such a proud moment for Jason Robinson. Lewis Moody had the honours last week against the Australians. Phil Vickery waited for Moody to take the field and then sprinted his team past the Wallabies at that stage, as he is doing again here at Stade de France. And they had the upper hand over the Wallabies in the early phases of that match. Phil Vickery again lets Jason Robinson absorb the accolades. 40,000 English supporters in the crowd. 40,000 French supporters in the crowd. There is no shortage of passion.
Yeah, Rupert, we saw a marked contrast, I think, between how England approached their quarterfinal to Australia. Australia were very relaxed, very composed, cool, calm and collected. England really fed off the passion, and, you know, they got in a huddle and they were hugging each other and firing each other up. Both these teams, passion personified. And you can just see, I mean, it gives you goosebumps watching sort of grown men hugging each other and making out with each other, nearly.
We'll see it in the anthem's door.
It's great when you've got two teams that believe they will win the game, and you've got two teams here that honestly believe they deserve a spot.
Reflections on the trials and the tribulations, the sweat and the tears, the dreams of young boys, posters on the wall leads them to here. C'est grand, this is big.
Well, even the referees are feeling the pressure, a little bit of love between them. Well, Sheridan, Reg and Vickery have a 28-kilo advantage in the front row over the French.
Yeah, the English have to dominate the French pack. If they can do that, they're going to give Johnny Wilkinson the time and space he needs to weave his magic.
Interesting to see Ibanez actually preferred to stand up in his front row pattern rather than leading his team by standing on the end. And the back row, they're just going to have a genuine crack at each other today. We said Moody was going to be under pressure, standing inside Wilkinson. His defence is still an issue.
Jonathan Kaplan, a big moment for the South African referee. Paul Honus and Marius Jonker on the sidelines. And our very own Stu Dickinson from down under up in the TMO box. Lionel Bowies, the up and under from the kickoff. And the French are there to contest the early exchange, but knock it on in the process.
Sheridan so often talked about this first scrum. Not sure if he actually hit it how he wanted to.
No ball.
The thing with Sheridan, I met him after the game, he's one of the nicest, sweetest men you'll ever meet, but someone must flick a switch in his head when it comes time to scrummage, because he was extremely volatile against the Australians last week. Very close setup by Kaplan. He's the only referee that sometimes likes to put his hands on the scrum, P and Gage, probably known as the best scrummaging referee in the world.
So as we saw last week in the quarterfinal between England and Australia, early problems with the scrum. No front row wants to concede any advantage at this point.
You can see the French already on setup 2 to 3 inches below, so he's penalising there for taking it down.
And the English play on quickly. Taking it forward is Nick Easter. The little bulldog Gomesall clears to the left. And that cotton wool in the air belongs to Simon Shaw. Gomesall, the box kick, was Lucy onside. Damien Cray. Lucy gathers. Lucy has scored a try. Unbelievable in the opening moments of this match. Less than 90 seconds on the clock. And Josh Lucy collects the bounce over the top of Damien Cray and scores a spectacular five-pointer.
Well, wake up, France. Have a look at that. Not even 2 minutes in, Lucy has pinned his ears back. Amen's wandered back, pretty much. That says it all.
It wasn't like it was a positional issue. He had plenty of time, plenty of space. But you've just got to go for the ball. You can't second-guess your opposition. They're always going to be pouring through on you.
It was a wonderful kick from Andy Gomesall. Damien Trey slipped. And Josh Lucy, well, he timed his run perfectly. The perfect start for England if Johnny Wilkinson can convert, but it's out to the left. Just over 2 minutes gone. Stade de France semi-final number one. England 5, France 0. Drama already.
Well, that's great chase from Lucy. Look at that tap on the head. Thank you very much.
So England starting like the proverbial house on fire. They did it last week against the Wallabies, not with a try as early as that. That will give them confidence. It certainly will bring their crowd into the equation nice and early.
Johnny just getting a left footer away. Got to settle the boys down a bit. Emotions will be high. He's got to try to settle down the nerves.
So the first line out of the match, and Bonaire takes to the air and brings it down for Le Bleu, and you will hear that tonight from the crowd. Allez Le Bleu. We've heard it all week on the streets of Paris. So an Englishman extracted from the ruck. Nelisalde finds Bowies, the kick is high. Jason Robinson takes the mark in his 50th test.
Great take. I think we got an indication there of what we'll see a fair bit from the French early on. Bowies trying to put a little bit of pressure on Robinson. He's pretty solid under the high ball, so I'm expecting him to handle that quite easily.
Well, France, they're going for the seven-man drive. Nick Easter was basically right on the ball there and shut their line-out drive down. It'll be interesting to see what England go for. Seven men, they love setting up drives and going from there. No, they're going a shorter option. Sorry, it's France's ball, they're going five men.
Ibanez once again, this time finds Tion. Some work from the forwards, Dusatois and Serge Betson. Elisal. The little kick through from Lionel Bowie's bounced off English feet. Ibanez was there to clean it up. So halfback on halfback, and Gomesel wins that fight. Easter clears the ruck. Regan, Tate, they're going wide. Martin Corrie found the try scorer, Josh Lucy. And the tackle from Bonair.
Well, we saw this a couple of times last week, what the English did against the Wallabies, really attacking that breakdown, causing a couple of turnovers, and when they do, they go wide straight away.
So five gone, Stade de France, five on the board for England. This time, Betson brought it down for LSL. Bowie's, the pass was loose. Marty picked it up and carried it forward. Dusatoir scored the try against the All Blacks last week that gave the French side confidence. David Marty strong once again. Back to the right, the French. Bowies finds Josion. Dusatoir, he's everywhere in the early stages. So the platform this time is good for the French. And that field goal must have been attempted from close to 60 metres. It's play on, and Serge Betson, he's on the spot. Recycles the ball, Elisal. Josion takes the hit and bounces back inside.
Watch out, watch out.
Jean-Baptiste Elisal finds his skipper. Ibanez, the most capped hooker in the history of the game. Advantage France. Bowies, they have some space. That's Amans. But we will come back for the penalty.
You could see why England were trying to shut it down as quickly as they could. They were caught short side. They only had four men up against six on that other side of the field. France still able to go down that passage. Clean break wasn't made, so the penalty incurred. I think that's Easter right on the ball.
Not at a kick.
An ambitious field goal attempt. You're right, Rupert, I think that was about 60 metres out. This is pretty much how, this is the French way of playing rugby at the moment. They just probe and probe, have a couple little runs. They're very patient, and they wait for the slightest hint of an overlap or maybe a mismatch, so a forward attacking, attacking a forward, and they take that opportunity and try to make the most of it.
Lionel Bowies from dead in front makes no mistake, and now France are on the board as well. So the French absorb the early blow of an English try. Get themselves on the board in the eighth minute. They trail by two.
Interesting to see how many resources the French put into the first breakdown of set piece, because the English were so good at counter-up on the first phase against Australia. Seven there.
So Bonair's good work from the restart is rewarded. The kick-finding touch from Damien Trey, playing his second consecutive test in a jersey that he has been largely unfamiliar with across his career, that being the 15.
The English will really want to pressure both Bowies and Trey. They know the French are going to try to play a fair bit of field position if they can, so plenty of kicking.
So that time it's loose from England, and the French capitalise. Elisalde spins it, Bowies back inside to Yannick Josion, scored what turned out to be the match winner last week. Left the All Blacks absolutely devastated. Charge down from England, and the race is on. Ibanez and Regan, the two hookers, go at it. Finally, David Marty rescues the French.
I don't know if you classify that as a chase. Two hookers pinning the ears back. Still great pressure from the English. I mentioned it before. They're going to really want to pressure the French kickers. Even got their hookers doing it.
Well, I'll give it to Ibanez by a short half head.
Keep heads up, right side.
The French have got to put a lot more distance between their nine and their kicker in general field play because the English are putting a huge amount of pressure off them off the breakdown. Big scrum.
Same again.
You can see the folding of the bodies. The French are trying to take Sheridan down as low as they can. Sheridan is very, very tall for a loose head prop. Taller the loose head prop, the lower you've got to take it to the deck. Again, we've talked about how they outweigh them. Sheridan even slipping over the top on that one. The big man, he doesn't like it down there.
So the French, with their backs on the try line, this is such a significant aspect of the game. The scrum, and certainly the English have the territory and the forward momentum right here, right now. Elisal tried to spoil, the referee said play on. Here's Billy Wiz, Jason Robinson, met and driven back. Nick Easter picks and gets things going in a better direction for England. Sheridan himself.
Okay, leave it.
So Easter to Wilkinson, Mike Catt finds some pace, and that is Paul Sackey. The man can run.
Squeeze ball. Leave it.
I cannot believe how much problems Aits have been having keeping balls in the back of the scrum, not letting go behind their feet.
But was that
down time? Yeah, it was. It went behind his feet just for 1 second. That's enough. As soon as it goes out, it's out. Skinstad's had the same kind of problems. You've just got to really keep it at the feet of your second row, and this French were smart enough to take it across field, make it difficult for Easter to keep in. Turnover. Here we are on the 22 of the opposition.
The English haven't beaten the French at Stade de France since the year 2000. Will this be their night?
Hold.
Such a big night. Rugby World Cup semi-final. Dussatois pass inside the Tion.
Leave it now, White!
The French cracked here on the opening night against the Pumas. One feels that they put those demons behind them as Serge Benson does some good work at the breakdown.
Again, the French there got a little bit of distance between themselves, Alassalde and Boisse. Line-out time, England have got to put some numbers up at the back. That's the third line-out in a row that France have won on five-man. Easy ball at the back. It gives 10 such opportunity to get momentum into the opposition. Amazing, Ibanez throws one-handed. He's the only hooker really that's left in international rugby. Throws with one hand.
So you can hear and feel the noise in your lounge rooms back home. And Rafael Ibanez knows it. The communication finally, and it's good work there done again by Bonnier.
The English are happy to let him go a couple of yards as long as they can get him to the ground. That was Kay on that occasion, just pulling it down by the back.
So Fabien Palus in his 118th test for his country. And the high kick from Boisse. Josion gets Jace. Well, Lucy never got close to it. The ball bounces now for England.
Wait there, seven.
The kick this time from Cat.
Yep.
Stays in the field of play. Vincent Clerc
out.
Returns the favour. Puts the pressure on his opposite number. Now Nick Easter. The boys in white rumble it downfield. Elisalde. Cat once again standing in the fly-out position. His kick is high. Damien Trey met by a couple of English chasers. Sackey was one. Elisalde dashes left. And the English weather another attacking storm from the French. Josion makes the pass. This time the hands find Peter De Villiers. Elisalde. Damien Trey gets over the halfway line. Serge Betson steadied the ship for the French. So Josion back inside the Dussatois. Thierry Dussatois, one of the form players for the French in this tournament, executes well again. The French stringing the phases together. Josillon, Vincent Clerc this time distributes. Here they come. Heymans steps off the left, looks for Ibanez. Great work, France, but the pass went forward.
Well, they're not going to let him get away with another one this week, are they? Well, what an amazing... Have a look. They pan out here. Have a look at the players. How many players are on the ground here trying to get their breath back. An amazing passage of play. The longer that passage of play goes on, this the greater chance that this can happen, where you can get a mismatch where a back can attack a tied forward, and that's when opportunities arise.
The two things that were happening there is, one, England were having a lot of difficulty on the fold. They weren't getting around quick enough, and so the French, if they kept going on the flow pattern the same way, they were finding themselves with an enormous amount of space. The other thing, Saki came off his wing. We talked about that last week, and it almost went pear-shaped for him. Then he managed to get across and get the tackle in time on the sideline.
Well, you live by the sword, sometimes you die by it. South Africa outsmarted Saki in the pool match a few weeks ago. He was caught short. Tonight, what impact will that man make? Sebastian Chabal.
Well, he was amazing against England in the trial match they had before the World Cup. Came on, ran through five blokes to score the try. He's better against tired defenders. He'll have a bigger impact. Great scrum ball for England.
So the scrum marches forward and Easter uses that platform to make a wonderful run. That time it's turned over from the English. And it was Martin Corrie.
Well, that was disappointing from Corrie, because that was a great scrum and a great run from Easter, well over the advantage line. Unfortunate. Well, credit to Betson, actually. That was a good, solid impact on the tackle, and he actually dislodged that ball.
It's a great tackle from the man from Biarritz, Serge Betson. And this time,
do not even try.
The English penalised for taking it down.
Scrum's going down because you're not taking the bar. Off you go.
Well, we know how strong Sheridan is, and he's given an opportunity there. Shepherdson said a lot of the time in contact there that he was basically being deadlifted straight off the deck. So we can see De Villiers here taking it down nice and low. Sheridan can push himself off with his left elbow, but now he just drops it on the deck. I'll take that. He thinks he can accept a penalty out of it. Kaplan the other way around gives the penalty to England, to France. My apologies.
I would have thought after that last scrum, why would England, you know, I mean, that they're obviously dominating that area of the game. Doesn't make sense that they would want to bring that down.
Well, again, it's hard for him, but he should have just dropped his hips. He's strong enough and big enough to keep scrums up. I did take it down. Loose heads, you've got to keep it up.
To Lionel Bowies. He did it the first time. He does it the second. The French are in front. Applause from Sebastian Chabal and co on the bench.
Just to complete that point, Sheridan was taking a risk to try to get a penalty out of the referee, and it backfired.
So the warfare continues, not only in a physical sense but a psychological sense. And Nick Easter plays on quickly to Robinson. Robinson is brought down. Now it flies through the back line, hands onto the boot of Mike Catt, and that is a good touch finder.
That is a great touch finder. That's a big advantage England have with having Wilkinson and Catt. You have two fulcrums, I guess, you can either kick or run from. So all the pressure can come onto Wilkinson. He can transfer that pressure. Catt can then take the ball and get the kick away.
Julien Bonnaire. He has been a significant go-to man in the French lineup. English.
Entry from the side and diving over.
Well, they did it last week against the Wallabies. And they're not happy with the decision from Jonathan Kaplan. A little bit of back chat and another 10 metres.
Interesting. One week he'll have an enormous amount of luck on the counter up. Next week he'll try the same tactics. And the thing, both teams were smart in what they did last week, was they adapted to the conditions. England need to adapt to their ability to counter-up in this game and slow down the ball.
And also adapt to the refereeing, because different referees will referee the breakdown differently. Kaplan obviously will have no bar of teams coming in remotely from the side. like Corrie did there.
Well, he didn't hold his feet either, mate. Corrie dived straight over the ball. Palouse. The experience will be vital this evening.
Just so you know, though, that's not players getting ready to come on literally every 20 minutes in a game. The trainer will get the reserves up, try to keep them warm, get the blood flowing again.
I used to hate that Mr. Exhaust.
Well, they predicted rain this weekend in Paris, but it hasn't come. Fantastic conditions for a wonderful game of rugby, and this will make history. Dussatoir doing some hard work in there. Bowie sends it wide, Josie on the pass to Damien Trey. It's a good tackle from Tate. But once again, the foundations are solid from the French. Tion. Jerome Tion and Julian Bonnier combine. Betson. Well, that was poor organisation from the French. Serge Betson didn't know that Lionel Bowies was setting himself for a drop kick. The pass was ordinary. It found touch, I suppose. We'll have a line out.
Show me your out. 1 metre here.
So Mark Regan.
I think he was screaming to Ben Kay for a line out call.
Well, it looked to be in disarray for the English. Simon Shaw got the result in the end. Once again, the box kick from Gomesel finds Vince St. Clerc. Scored a hat-trick of tries in his Rugby World Cup debut clerk, Jason Robinson. Well, he's not happy with the touch, Judge. That's Marius Jonker.
Well, I don't blame him. I mean, at first look, he has every right to do that. Let's have a look.
Was there a foot in touch? I guess we'll find out.
There's the ball. He has dropped it. That's nothing wrong with that at all.
Was his left foot out when he touched the ball again?
Let him come down.
No, it wasn't.
Let him come down.
Should be fine.
The immaculate skills of Jason Robinson were close to perfect there. Certainly good enough to keep the ball in play, but Marius Jonker ruled otherwise. It was a mistake from the touchy. And the French have it. Once again, the field goal is the option, and once again, the result is unsatisfactory for Bernard Laporte and his French side. This time, Vince Cedric Amens does manage to keep it in. Damien Trey. Right down the French with Mr. Wilkinson. The left foot torpedo finds its touch.
Just watch the five.
Poor old Bowies has had two poor kicks because the pass from the break from the breakdown has been absolutely terrible. He's had a lot of air about it.
Yeah, I think it's actually not El Assad passing it. I think he's been dragged into the breakdown, which is great work from the English. And then a forward has actually had to pass that ball, and it's just taken too long.
So as this line-out prepares to take place, an interesting picture we saw a moment ago. That man, Fabian Palouse, put his hand up. And Sebastian Chabal is warming up on the sidelines.
The French have won all of their seven lineouts so far unopposed, but their setup on the rolling ball has been smashed by the English. Because of it on this occasion, they've got a turnover.
And Gomesel capitalises. Wilkinson, a truckload more experience than Bowies. Damien Trey evades one. That was Mike Catt, the pass inside to Josillon. The French regain their composure. And Ayman's off the left. So many kicking options this French side. Ayman's, Bowies, Alassal, Damien Trey, David Marty, and Jason Robertson this time as well. But the English finds the touch.
Sorry, Rupert, good work from Trey there. Number one goal there is to beat the first defender. Once you do that, the defence in behind is normally a little bit splintered.
When the next defender came, he then transferred the ball. Good work from an inexperienced fullback, playing well.
So this is the drama of a rugby test match. Fabian Palouse is off and Sebastian Chabal is on, and from the body language of Palouse, it's significant and serious enough to cost him the rest of the match. Here come the English. Cat. Paul Sackey takes the pass with space. Robinson loves space because he has the speed as well.
Stay up, stay up.
Gomez or Wilkinson, and the English set up midfield.
One is out.
So back to the right they come. That's Phil Vickery, the skipper. Wilkinson, this time his drop goal attempt was better organised, but it's out to the left, so the score remains 6-5.
I was just going to mention before, I think the French wouldn't want Chabal on that early. He is an impact player, and we saw what he's capable of coming on against tired defences. This is just too early for him to make the kind of impact we're used to seeing him make.
Well, he'll have another option door. I mean, Palouse is off, he is injured. Should it have been Aronautiki?
I don't think so. I think even though Chabal normally plays eight, he's the best option they've got as far as the forward is concerned, particularly at scrum time.
So not ideal for the French. But that man, Sebastian Chabal, as you can see, the right of your screen,
right there,
is in the thick of the action. Wilkinson playing second off the ruck, the left foot grubber. Straight to Damien Trey, and Trey drills it downfield. So Mike Catt, all the time in the world. Not the perfect kick for him for all the time that he had.
Yeah, well, sometimes you can have too much time because you actually think about what you're doing.
Well, it was a better kick from Damien Trey. Josh Lucy protests, but he caught it in the field of play, and the tackle over the sideline gives the French the throw into the line-out.
Well, look, that was Gomesil's ball. The player coming forward needs to call that and take it. Lucy was in all sorts of trouble.
Well, it looked like it came off the knee of Damien Trey ultimately, so that's why Josh Lucy was disappointed. Martin Corrie, and how does the English line-out look at this stage?
Well, they've had two line-outs so far, and they've fudged them both. They've set up for the rolling ball here, and they've just stayed in field.
So they flirted with the sideline. Ben Kay makes the pass, and Josh Lucy, off his wing, takes it up hard. Here comes Tate.
Great tackle, Georgian.
Six from the side.
So he got beyond the advantage line, Matthew Tate, and that put Serge Betson in a position or an angle where he's transgressed and given away the penalty.
Simple thing about that is he's consistent. The team will be happy about that. They're just going to be cautious on their lines now. If you come in from the side, it means you've then got to go back around a little bit more. Careful about your lines. You can see Betson just on the inside. There he is at six. You've just got to took 1 or 2 feet to come around from the hindmost legs and enter the breakdown. It's hard because the ball's there. You want to take that opportunity to get the jackal and the turnover.
Serge Betson remembers with great disappointment, with great pain, the semi-final in 2003 when these sides met. He was yellow carded for a late tackle on this man, Johnny Wilkinson. Wilkinson's boot guided the English home to victory back then in Sydney. Here in Paris, the left boot of Wilkinson from 55. It's out to the right. And so the score remains 6-5 to the French. So half an hour gone at Stade de France. And it's tight. It's tough. Nick Easter has done that more than once, taking it forward for the English, giving Wilkinson an opportunity this time to spin it wide. Ben Kay standing out there in the centres.
Leave it to blue.
Well, the pass didn't quite hit its target right, and so he was a little bit standoffish, lacked a little bit of momentum.
Simon Shaw tries a little grubber kick. from his position in the centres, and I don't think Brian Ashton would be all that happy.
No, they're the first little signs that things aren't quite going the way the way the English would like, and you start getting locks trying to do grubber kicks. Oh, great tackle.
Big tackle, Vincent Clerk, the crunch.
It's interesting the mental impact that it has on forwards when you don't get the reward for effort. Shabal just down here.
Oh, well.
Then they'll be in some trouble come scrum time if Aaronautic gets to come on at left side lock. At the moment, the English forwards, if they're trying things like that, it means they're a little bit frustrated. They're trying to do things for themselves, and the thing in rugby is never do anything above your station. And second row is trying to make kicks is going to get them in trouble. It's 6-5 to France.
So Sebastian Chabal is being shown some concern from that breakdown. And the crowd roar as their man, their hero.
Come in, please.
Yes, Animal Sebastian Chabal regains his feet. He finds his place in the scrum.
Touch.
LSL to field.
Great scrum.
The hard side to bring up is the right-hand side. It means Vickery's got to change his angle. He's got to use that left leg and just work out at Miu. They got it nicely there. It really stops Alassal being able to hit his 10 with any kind of angle, so they're going to try it again here probably. They don't get it, and it's good ball.
It's much better ball for the French. Not a great pass for Bowies, but he did well. One bounce, a little right foot kick over the head of Saki. No option, Paul Saki. But to concede another line-out to Bernard Laporte's men.
I'm going to go on about it, but the point of difference, if you can get good scrum ball, the 10 gets the ball well, and he can take the options he wants to. If he goes pear-shaped, everything else does. It doesn't enable you to get a kick like this in.
Well, Saki, well, I don't know if he had no options. He had a fullback standing right there. Whether or not Robinson was telling him, hey, I'm unmarked, you had a bit of time.
Well, he is not the most experienced winger on the field, Paul Saki. This will be a massive occasion for him, as it is for everyone, but experience does play its part. Bonnier plays his part in the line-out once again.
Well, the 9 line-outs so far in the game, England have hardly gone up at all. All they're doing is just counter-rucking or counter-mauling, and it's worked again for them.
It certainly has. They've turned it over when they were under pressure. Cedric Amons caught it in the field of play. His left boot is high, and Robinson claims the mark.
I cannot believe he tore his hamstring 3 or 4 weeks ago against South Africa. He's just such a dynamic athlete.
Well, those hyperbaric chambers, they must be good. Did you find, as a player, you would have started before the old hyperbaric chamber, Chini, and played with them? Do they make much of a difference?
Oh, mate, who knows? And I guess at this level, you'll just try anything, to be honest. I mean, the science is there. The science backs up the soft tissue injuries, like a hamstring strain. Then, yes, they do. They promote blood flow to that area, which helps with the speed of the recovery.
Jason Robinson ticks that box. Serge Betson through his hands. Who's there first? It's the wily old veteran, Mike Catt. Was called back to the team last week. He did the job. He gets another opportunity. Cedric Amos, under no pressure, claims the mark for the French.
We talk about it often, Rupert and Dore. This 10 minutes before half time is a great indication of which team is particularly lifting for the occasion. Let's see what the last 7 minutes holds.
Well, you felt all week that it was going to be tight. There is so much more to come in this game. With 6.5 minutes to go until half-time, it is 1 English try to 2 French penalty goals. And this is a vital phase. The line-out from Ben Kay was pounced upon by Serge Betson. It was sloppy from the English. Chabal is back and firing. Jerome Keon just doing a little bit of renovation there. Bois, this time, it was a little more organised, but the result was the same. Jason Robinson shapes to run. Finds his touch instead. Julian Bonaire calls the line out and calls himself. It bounces for LSL, but it's set up nicely for him. And now the French spin it wide. Cedric Gomez got a little drop kick from the wing. So into the end goal, Jason Robinson, the teammate of Sebastian Chabal from the Sale Sharks.
5 minutes to go.
Dots it down, Jonathan Kaplan. You heard him confirm. 5 minutes to go until coaches will have the opportunity to say a few words.
It's interesting, isn't it? Some games will be scrum-based. I think we've only had 3 or 4 scrums in this game so far. We've had 19 lineouts, and it's the way that teams will play that will focus on it. England wanted to focus on the scrum last week. They got what they wanted.
Thierry Dussatoir. In the early stages of his test career, he's contributed significantly to the French effort, especially after the disappointment of night one. Bowie's to the air. Robinson will have time to make that cup of tea and then make the catch.
Yeah, too much time, way too much time. The whole point of that, and I'm sure Lepore is blowing up a bit about it, Robinson, when he catches that ball, needs a French defender hitting him at the same time.
We've seen him so much, particularly in 0-3 against Wales, tear teams apart on the counter-attack. He might take the mark, take that quick tap and then go. Even with the hamstring torn, he just seems to have that ability of acceleration and evasion.
So Lionel Bowies hasn't been so convincing in this first half for the French. He is only playing his 11th test. Frederic Michelac waits on the bench. And Dussatoir executes the line out well for the tricolours.
Hold there, 6.
They've played in so many Rugby World Cup semi-finals, the French. The pass just on from Josion to Marty, but the pressure there from the English defenders.
And it was because that first breakdown was slowed down by the English forwards that the D-line of the English was able to come up fast. And Tate was able to make that hit at the very least to slow things down. They couldn't get the offload.
Interesting in that defensive line there. Cat was flying in at Josion. Well, both Wilkinson and Cat were trying to tackle Josion. They obviously see him as a danger man as well.
Both doing something wrong. Three, keep your elbow up and let him bind. Let him bind. You're taking it down. No way.
Here we go. Come in. Kaplan into Vickery about his right shoulder.
Elbow up, I'll protect him from
the danger for him. He just tends to take his right shoulder, go a little bit high. See me, you're trying to get underneath him there. They've got that left hand side, good pressure.
To the left, they spin it. Robinson back inside to Lucy. Dussatoir leveled him. Wilkinson with plenty of depth. Pat, that pass was ordinary, and Tate was under pressure.
No hands now.
Somehow the English pick it up off the back, and Simon Shaw funnels it back to Gonsol and Wilkinson's boot. Damien Trey engages in the good old kicking duel. Mike Catt, South African born,
great seven,
man of great experience. Many will remember Jonah Lomu making footprints over the top of Mike Catt in 1995. He's bounced back.
The France came second best out of that kicking duel there. Now, within their own 40, this is where Wilkinson can be so dangerous.
Well, Lucy looks like he's grabbing at his hamstring now, so it's become a little bit contagious. In the English back line, Robinson passed the hamstring tear off to Lucy, and there it goes. You saw him, you can see him grabbing it. Tell you what, when you see players grabbing at the hamstring, it's not insignificant. It's a genuine strain.
It's an interesting one for the English as well, because Toby Flood and Dan Hipkiss, the two outside back reserves. Cedric Amons, yeah, the French winger, takes the mark. Jason Robinson, of course, can play on the wing. So if Lucy goes off, the reshuffle will be interesting. Sebastian Chabal cutting a fine line there, but making the tackle, putting the pressure on.
Time out.
So it's Dan Hipkiss.
Play on, play on.
The Leicester Tigers utility back, who replaces Lucy, at least for now. Hipkiss made his debut against Wales this August. So he's relatively fresh on the test scene. Simon Shaw and Easter. Andrew Sheridan doing some hard work. Jason Robinson, once again the pass was behind Robinson.
Scrum, he couldn't get away.
And that is half time. Stade de France. And the whistle of Jonathan Kaplan sends these great rivals to the sheds. 1 point separates them. England through the try of Lucy. The French, two penalty goals, lead by one.
Scenes there from Rugby Town. It's been set up across the Seine from the Eiffel Tower at Trocadero. A whole bunch of marquees, big pool in the middle, and lots of atmosphere as the teams prepare to come out. Jonathan Kaplan, the referee tonight, took charge of the only English victory over the French this year. That was in the Six Nations match at Twickenham. And funnily enough, he was involved in the only English victory in Paris, or the last English victory in Paris in 2000. He was a touch judge in that game. Now, Chabal and Ibanez having a good chat with Kaplan there. He's explaining something to Rafa Ibanez as we hand you back to Rupert McCall, Ben Darwin and Ben Tune.
So Ibanez prepares for 40 minutes of a match that feels like it is going to hinge on a twist or a turn, something special that is going to put one of these sides into a Rugby World Cup final.
Yeah, the game's still very much in the balance. My French isn't fantastic, but Kaplan explaining, or Ibanez explaining to his players, and Kaplan is really focusing on that breakdown, so all players have to really try to get in behind and come through the middle of the breakdown, not from the side. Obviously an area that he's going to be concentrating on in this second half.
D-lines from both teams at the moment are pretty impressive. No one's made a clean break as far as this game is concerned. So I think it's going to come down to kick chase. There might be some form of turnover from a kick chase, or the ability of a turnover at the breakdown to shift and then score. And kick accuracy as well from Wilkinson is going to be a massive issue. Has been poor so far. One of them is going to make a mistake or hit the target. That's going to get up.
This whole World Cup, actually having possession has been a negative thing. So the team normally with the least amount of possession has actually ended up winning the game. So if you have less possession but better field position, that's normally the side that's winning these games.
France won the game against New Zealand last week with 28% of the ball. So far England's had 35%, but it may have to come down to this guy, not Vickery Wilkinson.
You wish, Dor.
Bill Vickery will look to lay the platform. Johnny Wilkinson, can he do what he did to the French 4 years ago? Sebastian Chabal hopes not. He's on for Fabian Palus, who is injured and seems destined to take no further part in this match. Dan Hipkiss is on for Josh Lucy in the English back line, and that's a great start from Johnny Wilkinson. He finds his target.
Perfect restart from Wilkinson.
Nick Easter carries it on. Now it's Gomesall and Wilkinson again. Mike Catt. Lewis Moody, crazy horse. In his 51st test, gallops forward. Back to the right. Simon Shaw got rid of it. Paul Sackey. Serge Betson and a cruncher in store for him. The French tow it through, and now the chase and the race is on. Dan Hipkiss gets there first, and Cedric Hammonds wraps him up. Peter De Villiers showed great pace to be there as well. Gomesall. Now it's Mike Catt there playing halfback. Now Andy Gomesall arrives. So deep and desperate on their own line, Johnny Wilkinson raises the flag of the touch judge.
Another opportunity coming from a turnover. The English here, Saki in contact. Just loses the ball. Plain and simple.
By the way, the French just crunch on the defence at the moment. That was a fantastic tackle, but Miu was probably the cause for that turnover. He rolled down nicely on top of Saki. Ball rolled out to the side. Miu was the loose head prop for France.
So this much-beloved hooker, the man they call Rafa. It's not good for the French on that occasion. Tion's target was not found.
Incredible piece of play. Just watch how this midfield bomb goes.
Well, Damien Train knocked it on, and it's play on. Tate. This young man who's made another positive impact for England in this Rugby World Cup.
A little bit of an experience there from Trey at fullback. Just got in the air too early and ended up actually jumping past the ball.
Oh, England had space. I suppose they had forwards out there as well, but Olivier Mailloux in the French defensive line, that was going to be interesting.
Well, when you drop a ball as a prop, you pretend you've got an injury, as Phil Vickery's done just there. He's got his hands to it, and acrobatic as he is.
Yeah, timeout.
Wrong man for the spot, unfortunately. That old chestnut, I'm injured. That's why I didn't catch it.
Well, for the length of time that it's taken Phil Vickery to get his act together, the injury seemed to be realistic. Josh Lucy is off the field, so is Fabian Pelouse for the French. The French have it. Yes, they do, through the midfield. The ball laid back. Once again, it's loose. But this time,
entry.
The English come in from the side.
Like we said, as long as he's consistent, and I actually think that ball just popped out of the French making their own mistake.
Entry. Eight. Entry. Side.
Well, I know one thing. Lionel Boice will have no hesitation whatsoever in calling for the kicking tee. He was the man who made the break.
That's just sloppy work at the breakdown from the French. The ball positioning was fine. The second man in just had no control over what he was doing.
And France were just lucky. Easter just happened to end up in the wrong spot and never got his hand near the ball, but they still got a penalty.
So 74 test points in 11 matches. Become 77, and the French go further to the front. So 9-5 in favour of the home side. A side that has never won the William Webb Ellis Cup, playing a side that won the last trophy in 2003. The French have played in a couple of finals. So have the English. It's all to play for.
Again, the French have got to get more distance between the man and the halfback position and first receiver on kick. Interesting to see the last line out the French had. It's the first time the English defended, and they got a turnover at the back.
So the ball from the 22 restart bounced off an Englishman into the hands of a Frenchman. A little kick through. Great work, Lewis Moody. And it provides an opportunity for Dan Hipkiss. Hipkiss the pass, Mike Catt. This is Matthew Tate. Here comes the cover. Tate 3 metres away.
Tate is right.
English have the advantage. And they have the space out wide. Hipkiss once again takes it back inside. Jason Robinson in his 50th test. David Marti brings him to the ground. Andrew Sheridan laying the bricks for England. But now the penalty.
Entry.
There it is again. We're going to hear that word, I think, hundreds of times. All right, that's an exaggeration. But plenty of times today, entry, entry, players not coming, the players coming in from the side at the breakdown.
You can treat him.
Lewis Moody, fantastic work. Created this opportunity. And Tate pinned the ears back. But Rupert, you mentioned it. Great cover defence.
I think we're about to swing low door.
Well, given what's happened in this game so far, surely a chip and chase inside your own 40 is not the smartest option. Because the D-lines are so good, the only opportunity that's going to come is turnover shift, and that's exactly what England did so well there.
You called it, and you called it well, Ben Bowen. Yannick Jozian in his 50th Test match this evening, let's not forget that. He together with Jason Robinson playing in their 50th Test. Olivier Mihieu is another one celebrating that milestone this evening. The French prop. But this time Jozian gets it wrong. Johnny Wilkinson certainly hasn't been kicking at his best in this tournament or in this match. Brian Ashton hopes. The English supporters pray. Johnny Wilkinson ponders the task. And Johnny Wilkinson performs. Another three for the English. So the half-time deficit is restored. That is 1 point. The French still lead.
Ball, 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 ball.
The seesaw continues.
Keep quiet.
The French too keen from that kickoff.
It's all about the eyes. They weren't looking straight up at the ball. If they're looking at the opposition, then you're entitled to the penalty. It's a strange thing. It's not how the referees look at it, but oftentimes they'll hit their target in that way.
Came in their thousands. Last night and today, white jerseys on the streets of Paris, white jerseys on the green fields of France.
Leave him, leave him, leave him.
Gomesel and Wilkinson combined with a forward to find the halfway line. This time the little kick from Andy Gomesel. Damien Trey takes his time, settles the ship for the French, who in the last 5 minutes or so have taken a few wrong options. They look a little bit rattled.
Nice piece of refereeing there by Kaplan, as opposed to penalising England for being offside. Just pulled Simon Shaw back from being in an offside position, so it didn't affect the flow of the game.
Rupert, when are we going to see the Michelac burger? It's about time. I think that the French need a bit of a spark.
Well, the French supporters are hungry for it. There is no doubt about that. And Frederic Michelac, as he did last week against the All Blacks, is quite capable of lighting a magical spark. Gomesel for now finds Mike Catt. That pass was on the borderline, and so was that one. This to Jonathan Catlin, the South African, catches up.
Strong.
With the English.
He's having a great game. He's been absolutely consistent at the breakdown with the forward passes.
It's interesting we mentioned Michelac just before there was a forward pass on the field. It was line ball, but it seemed to be right. It seems to be listening to his touches. He's refereed the scrums very well as well.
Crouch, touch.
He loves that hand on the props to tell where they're going to come in. You can see where de Villiers is heading now.
On the hit.
He gives up 13 or 14 kilos to Sheridan. Regan is into them. He never stops talking.
Square on, please. There's the mark.
Yep.
Crouch, touch, pause, and go.
The Marseillais reverberates through Stade de France. The scrum is packed. It's spoilt at the back four. Little Jean-Baptiste. The kick over the top, though. Well, Mate, he made up his mind before he actually caught the ball. Now he's under pressure.
Stop.
little bulldog Andy Gomesall. He made his test debut in 1996.
I cannot tell you how outstanding that scrum was by de Villiers. He's played Sheridan perfectly this game, and now he's started to find the channel. And here comes Michalak. Krzyzewski's also on the field for Ibanez.
So Dmitry Krzyzewski, and that man, Mr. Michalak, he turns 25 on Tuesday. He would rather celebrate that birthday focusing on a Rugby World Cup final. Krzyzewski. That match you mentioned, Bendal, the lead-up game, the warm-up match, where Sebastian Chabal scored the try that won the game for the English. Well, Krzyzewski made a match-winning tackle, a try-saving tackle on Phil Vickery. The little twists, the little turns, half an hour to go. The ball rolls forward for the French. And down the right-hand side, Jean-Baptiste Alassal. Andy Gomesall kicks it dead, and so we'll come back for a 5-metre scrum.
Nice piece of work there by Krzyzewski going short side. They knew that their rolling balls had difficulty all day, so he decided to make that short pass, a nice little kick through, and that could have gone any which way.
That's what you want from your bench players. They need to make an immediate impact. Krzyzewski, in that instance, did so. Nice deft hands from him. Created the opportunity, and as you said, that could have easily gone the French way.
Well, they've called it a melee of cultures across the tournament, and melee is the French word for scrum, and there might not be a more significant scrum in this match than this one, Ben Darwin.
Well, they've showed everyone else in the world how to scrummage against what is the best front row, no question, in the world. Heyman's the best tight head. This is the best working group. The scrum together is England, and they're going to try to put some heat here back on the French. And it's French ball. I can't see them going for the pushover, but at the very least, they want to get it in and out as quick as they can.
Intensity, adrenaline, and a French scrum. Bonaire off the back. It was loose for LSL. The flick pass was brilliant. Vincent Clerc steps inside. Lewis Moody and co were there to meet him.
Michalak back for a drop kick.
Frederick Michalak. Well, it was ugly. Paul Sackey applied the pressure. And Frederick Michalak off the mark with that one. What about this? Could have been anything. Could have been disaster. In the end, it was beautiful for the French. It's the way they play. And how much did Michalak miss by?
Well, Chabal ran across the face of the pass and it may have ruined it a little bit for them. Always running his own agenda, Chabal. You never know where he's going to pop up.
So Wilkinson this time for England. Cedric Amans, he played fullback on opening night. Much more comfortable on the wing. The pass to Michalak was a little bit of a floater from LSL, but the right boot. He looked for the bounce, he didn't get it. Matthew Tate will fire this pass to Johnny Wilkinson once again for the 22 drop.
Well, we know Michalak's a confidence player, so for him personally, he just needs to get his first couple of plays right, and his French teammates will feed off that.
It's so important for the English in this part of the field not to make a mistake, because they'll be punished for it. Happened against South Africa so many times.
Time on.
Joe Worsley, in his 64th test, replaces the mad dog, Lewis Moody. We'll consider that he's done a pretty good job, but he leaves the game perilously poised in the balance. Dusa Twa to Amans. Elisald. Michalak. Josillon. Back to Frederic. He bounced out of the tackle of Hipkiss. And the French swing it to the left. Josillon and Serge Betson. He took the tackle.
It's all English forwards on that side of the field. They should have gone with Whip. They're still there.
Still there with Dusa Twa. Thierry this time was happy to take it himself. LSL under immense pressure. It will come back to the English. The pass from Vickery to Wilkinson and the chase. Michalak retrieves the situation for the French.
That's usually smart from Betson. When you see Fatties, you've got to use width. They had five tight forwards on that side of the field and one winger in defence. They should have gone wide. They didn't. Turnover to England.
Ellisald isolated on that occasion. George Gregan knows what it feels like. The English turn it over. Simon Shaw. The crowd sense it. As Ben Kay bumps it down for sure, it's loose. The players must sense that in the remaining 25 minutes, somebody will put their hand up. Gomisil and the foundation from the English. It was good from Regan.
Chabal, turnover.
Sebastian Chabal. Well spotted, Ben Darwin. The animal. He's not just big and mean, but he's also crafty. Josie on Michelac. Oh, Frederic. They get the advantage, but once again, the French flirting with enigma.
Yeah, stinky kick there from Michelac. Didn't have an effect, I guess, in the end.
Well, if the English catch this and break the defensive line, it's a try. I mean, they knocked it on in the end. But that's Frederic Michelac. You do not know what you're going to get. Imprevisible, unpredictable. As Matt Stevens, the gambler, takes the field for Phil Vickery.
Still amazed he can play guitar with fingers that big, but Stevens is a good tight end prop.
And that's a great scrum from the English.
How did they get that out of there?
Well, Bonaire somehow squeezed it out the back, and Michelac, the midfield bomb. Saki, sensational. He defied his experience there, Paul Saki. The result for England is Wilkinson off the left.
What's your wait for?
Straight down the middle of the field, and Johnny saw the space. Amos and Trey looping around.
What a difference between the two sides tonight. I don't think the English have had any charge downs against them, whereas the French probably had five or six during this game. It's either delivery of the 10 or the distance of the 10.
Phil Vickery is off the field. I guess it would make sense that Martin Corey will take over as the skipper, having been the captain in this tournament.
That's exactly right, and he's done a good job last week. Vickery simply doesn't have 80 minutes in him.
So Ben Kay to the hoots and the roars of an English crowd. Monster their way upfield. The French fight fire with fire.
You see Bonaire there trying to get his hands on the ball. He's fallen down. He was onside the whole time.
A little box kick from Gomisil. Were the chasers onside? Cedric Amos had time.
Here.
The mark claimed.
Push back 12.
He's looking 12. For Damien Trey. Saki with the pressure and Trey with the kick. So the England won't be unhappy with this result.
Given the scenario, everyone talks about someone putting their hand up and doing the right thing. It may be someone putting their hand up and doing the wrong thing, particularly inside your own zone.
Who will crack? Who will rise? Who will go through the Rugby World Cup final next week? The pass to Matthew Tate, Vincent Clerc. And Jerome Tion combined. Here come the English. Ben Kay. Gomisil and Wilkinson with the field goal. It's the right boot again. It bounces back. Vincent Clerc got the bounce and the kick away. It is a game of inches. Robinson fakes the kick. He bounces through 1-2. Jason Robinson. They know that it's coming, but they still can do nothing about it.
Chabal again.
Oh, Sebastian. The jackal.
He did it last week. He got two turnovers against the All Blacks and he came
isolated,
on late.
Isolated, man on his feet.
He was isolated. Shabal was straight in on the ball. On this feet. Is the drop kick by Wilkinson off the post. It may come down to things as simple as that.
That was an extraordinary looking drop
kick. Wait till we get there.
Did not strike it well at all. Jason Robinson. How hard is he to tackle with a bit of space? They actually had a flat defensive line. He found, I think, a gap about 30 centimetres wide and grafted his way through it.
Well, Paul Simon, the renowned singer, was born on this day in 1941. And on this occasion, it's here to you, Jason Robinson. He almost scored the try. And this is what's going to make or break this match, this roller coaster. Johnny Wilkinson's kick hits the post. The experience for the French is Christophe Dominici, who replaces Cedric Amans. And Chabal, who turned it over at the breakdown, does it for the French at the line-out.
Again, the English are doing a good job of disturbing that setup. They're never able to keep tight, the French.
Hold it! Hold it!
To Elisalde. This time the French look for that platform. It was Betson and Dussatois. And they got away with it last week, the English, but Jonathan Kaplan,
the halfback, didn't have the ball.
He's had a closer eye on it. Let's have a look at the replay.
Hit 10.
So the Ben Kay or Matt Stevens.
Where is he? There.
Just touching the halfback there. It's Stevens.
Yeah, coming through on the halfback when he didn't have his hands on the ball.
South African penalising a South African.
Yeah, Matt Stevens, born in Durban. He can sing. He made the final of a singing contest. Raised $125,000 for Nelson Mandela's charity.
Let him take it, it's his ball.
And unfortunately, he was the one that made a pretty crucial error against the South Africans deep inside his own zone. Just loves the counter ruck. Got himself into trouble there.
So with Andrew Sheridan on guitar and George Shooter on saxophone, who will sing for the English? Who will roar for the French? They have the ball. They have the territory. Elisalde marching his troops onwards and upwards towards the try line. They cross the 22. Zarzewski has it.
Yes, Simon Shaw. Great work to get his hands on the ball in that maul.
Josian back inside to Marti. This time he is isolated.
But Stevens has got it now.
That's turnover.
Delaney. Well, that is off the side of the boot, but it will give Sacchi an opportunity to contest. Damien Trey did well. He's brought to the ground by Cat. Now we're on the 50. Elisalde and Michelap once again over the head of Matthew Tate. It's Johnny Wilkinson, in fact, and Wilkinson, blonde on blonde.
At this stage of the game that the kick chase lines start to fall apart a little bit. There's these fantastic opportunities as Robinson took earlier. And the ability to offload from this kind of scenario from Trey may give them the try they want, France.
Well, you can see the white in the crowd. You can also see the red and the blue that matches the white of the French flag. Wilkinson goes long. That's Vincent Clerc. Scored the try. Sealed the deal for the French in a Six Nations match against the Irish in front of a similar crowd. Chabal, Le Crunch.
They were waiting for him. Great hit.
Play it.
Elisalde under pressure and Michelac dodges and weaves. Betson lost it, regained it. It comes back for the French.
Push back one.
The roller coaster continues. Michelac climbs aboard. Little kick for his winger, Vincent Clerc. Where's the bounce? Into touch.
Well spotted from Michelac. Notice Clerc was unmarked out wide. The English defence coming up pretty quickly, actually, which is pretty impressive for 63 minutes. Have a look at this hit on Chabal. Great contact.
Matt Stevens. It's been impressive since he took the field.
Should have started.
Time.
So it's an English line out. Mark Regan, the Bristol hooker who came out of retirement this year for the Rugby World Cup, shakes off the cobwebs and rejoins his team. 15 minutes to go on a knife edge. That's an understatement.
You just get the impression next team to score, particularly if they can score a try, it's going to be pretty hard to wind them in.
So the line out back for the English, and Andrew Sheridan once again lays the bricks for England. Great work there from Joe Worsley. Mike Catt looks for a runner, and he finds one in Simon Shaw. He's ridden to the ground by the Villiers. They turn it over, and Ellis Saud, like a thief in the night, pickpocketed the All Blacks last week and finds some open space with his kick. It's Lil Johnny back there for the English, and Jason Robertson sighting the slipper. Jean-Baptiste Fuchs is on for the French. He replaces that man De Villiers, and this is a line-out worth contemplating. George Shooter, the bearded hooker, does the same thing for England.
Keep trying the drive, the French. They're just looking to offset themselves to the right. The English have done a terrific job. They're getting better and better at it, the French. They've got good body height here. The English are too high.
So listen to the crowd. You'll know that the French are going forward with that. Michelac, a little kick through. Where's it bouncing? Oh, Tate.
22.
He was there for the English.
Great take from Tate. Running backwards, ball coming over your shoulder. Throw into the mix the fact that it was right under the goalpost. Great work from the young 13.
Shamal doing a great job at the moment, taking over on the lineouts. Maybe not in the calling, but at the very least on the drive from Palouse.
So Johnny Wilkinson, the Newcastle Falcon teammate of Matthew Tate. Vincent Clerc from that kick puts it up, and Robinson is up to the task. Here come the French once again, though. They hit the breakdown with power and at pace.
And they shut down Robinson as soon as he caught it as well.
So, for the moment, the territory is with the French. Mike Catt. So much experience, and that expression means that this game is so very close.
They're both extremely experienced 22s for the French and the English. It's this kind of scenario. They need all of that experience.
Emmanuel Arunordiki replaces Serge Betson. Once again, not much experience lost.
Well, he was one of the players of their fantastic win over the All Blacks. When he came on for Betson, he was everywhere.
Well, that took place a lot earlier in that match than what Arunordiki expected. Tonight he has 14 minutes and 10 seconds. Make that 11 seconds. And every second, every inch, every play is vital. Chabal, Michelac back inside. Got past Wilkinson.
And away, and away. Push back.
De La Salle. The high kick from Bowies. Arunordiki does well in the air. So advantage to the French. Once again, Arunordiki was on the spot. De La Salle. Josie on in his 50th. Volleyball from Vincent Clerc. He's ankle tapped. Sebastian Chabal. The anaesthetist. So close. The French go left. The crowd roar. And the French
forward
with the scrum. 12 minutes to go. Great work from Le Bleu.
Well, that's a little bit of volleyball. Have a look. Great skill from a back rower. And oh, just ankle tapped Clerc. Chabal, hard man to bring down that close. Could be the turning point of this match. French scrum on the English line.
it hasn't been sexy from Shabal because he's not running open field, but he's been outstanding. It's 9-8 to France. Toby Flood joins the hurricane of rugby that is blue on white and blue with the territory, blue with an opportunity for possession, and blue, allez le bleu from the crowd. LSL did so well there, it was out. He joined the ruck. Michalak as well. Sebastian Chabal. The pick and the drive. Dusatois lends a hand.
All down. Player holding him.
And more drama unfolding. A penalty to the English. The French not holding their feet.
Eight on the ground. No, no.
It's against Bonaire. Yeah, he was holding, I think, Gomesall on the ground. Gomesall was pleading with the referee, let me up, let me up, let me up.
So England find their touch through Wilkinson, and they will have the throw to this line out, but territory is still with the home side.
And on he comes, Delalio, he wants an experience. Comes on for Easter.
He said during the week, Lawrence Delalio, you don't have to play everyone in a Rugby World Cup. You just have to beat everyone in your way. The French stand in the way of the English and back-to-back Rugby World Cup finals.
Hold.
They trail by one. Gomesall, the box kick. Vincent Clerc is capable of being so brilliant. He puts it on the right boot. Robinson blocks it. Kicks it himself.
Wait, 21.
No. Damien Trey criticised for his selection of fullback, and almost set up for Dominici.
Hello.
Some serious strife for an English player. It might be
Honus levelled him in the hit.
Gomesall's hit on Paul Honus.
Left shoulder. He's a big Kiwi boy.
Yes, it's my neck. It's all right, mate. Yeah. Coming back.
You can see there that Andy Gomesall is in some trouble, and Paul Honus wandered over and said, sorry, mate. If Gomesall is under any cloud of doubt here, how many times will that be replayed? He leaves the field, Andy Gomesall.
Come on.
Peter Richards takes his place. Could there be any more drama? Chabal.
We always said referees have an impact on the game. I just didn't think touch judges had that big of an impact.
Let's go, scrum now.
I don't think Honus had been on the field yet, so it's a nice way for him to make his impact. Get his face on the telly.
Well, they've been billing this match as Le Crunch all week. There's another man who suffered, Frederick Michalak, from a similar collision. Well, less than 10 minutes to go. And now this, Johnny Wilkinson being treated for an injury. Frederick Michalak is down. Andy Gomesall ran into a touch judge. He's off. What next?
Yes, Mark Lussari and your two first receivers are down. Looks like something to do with a hip injury here for Wilkinson. He went into the contact on Chabal. Might have been a head.
I think it was his elbow, right where you don't really want to get hit.
I think Chabal cleaned up both 5-8s in one play there. His own man Michalak and then Johnny Wilkinson. He is an impact player. Richards, the replacement half. England feeds the scrum, and Delalio, the experience at the back. Played every minute of the last Rugby World Cup tournament. Wilkinson's back. And the kick. Well, he didn't get the wrong, and it was the top spinner straight on the Dominici. Trey hoists it high, Dominici chases. They waited for Richards to come back to earth before effecting the tackle. Hip kiss. He
is the acting halfback for England. This time Wilkinson finds touch.
We talked before the game, there's two men the Frenchmen nullify. One is Sheridan, the other is Wilkinson. They've nullified Sheridan. Their scrum for the French has been absolutely outstanding. Let's see if they can chuck down Wilkinson late in this game.
Well, he's definitely not striking very well. He has not had his best kicking game by a long way.
So Jerome Tion, he said during the week, the most important thing is to win, not to play beautiful rugby. And it has been ugly at times, but the French are winning. Whether they will go on and achieve victory, we'll find out in the next 8 minutes. They have the ball. It's right on the halfway line. They turn it over. Richards and Wilkinson, he'll play for territory. Advantage over. Michalak this time. Well, that kick hasn't found touch. And the English have the upper hand. Robinson, the pinball machine again.
Hold.
Those in white now get excited. Richards, Toby Flood with a drop goal. His first touch. And it was very, very unconvincing.
Well, that was just an experience from Flood. That was uncalled for. You've got to play the odds. I mean, a field goal 40 metres out, close to the side of the field, just isn't a smart play.
And England had the momentum.
He made his Rugby World Cup debut last week against the Wallabies with 18 minutes. And a rush of blood there for the young man, Toby Flood. Trey. That's ugly off the boot. Zaki. He stopped. He stuttered and he spluttered. But he gets it back for Richards. Wilkinson. The pass to no one in particular, but Flood picks it up. David Marti takes him across the field in a tackle. Hip kiss. The pick and the drive. The English with position. Maybe Wilkinson for the field goal. Robinson stands one off. It was a high tackle. Advantage being played. And Sarzeski has given away a penalty that might prove vital in this semi-final.
Talk time about out. The man making a mistake inside your own 40. He's only 4 foot off the ground, Robinson, but you've got to get low. No matter how low the man is, you've got to go below his shoulders.
Yes, thanks.
It was clumsy, wasn't it?
It was clumsy. Okay. This is definitely within Johnny Wilkinson's kicking range.
So that boot, the left boot of that man, Johnny Wilkinson. As the clock ticks over at Stade de France, and the pages of the rugby history books turn as well. Will victory hinge on this? It's 3 for England. They're in front by 2, 11-9. And the army in white, they like it.
Well, the French were starting to get tired at the breakdown. They were unable to slow down the English ball. That's what got England into that position in the first place. And unfortunately for Krzyzewski, the mistake was made.
So the short, high restart from Frederick Michalak. It bounces back for the English. Play on. You know what Wilkinson will do here. He'll play it like he knows how to play it and drill it. He doesn't find touch though, and Dominici, the pass back to inside the tray. Now the French with an opportunity. Michalak. They haven't scored a try in this match. Chabal takes it forward. But great defence from the English. Saki and Flood.
Absolutely filthy there. The French wanting to keep this ball in play. They're just handing over possession to the English. Good defence from the two backs.
Great defence on the big man, Sebastian Chabal.
What is your decision? I haven't seen anything.
Penalty.
Against?
Against blue.
Blue four? A blue sub? Okay. For what?
Jab in the face.
Okay.
This is Shabazz's reaction to being
tackled. After the tackle, the man was out. He put an elbow to the face. No more. Out.
Well, that's massive. That is a big call from Marius Jonker, the South African touch judge, confirming with his fellow South African Jonathan Kaplan that the penalty is Wilkinson's.
Talk about turning points. England now will try to hang on to this ball.
Let him come down.
Try to get the French to commit, obviously, another penalty.
So the English are up by 2 points. They have the line out. Shooter finds Martin Corey, no mistake. From Mr. Corey. And the English in this situation. This is the play. This is the platform. Don't be surprised if you see the boot of Wilkinson. The French appear as though the wind is out of their sails.
Corey was screaming at his forwards, then he turned around, faced the French himself, kept the drive going. The setup's pretty good. Are they going to break out? They do.
Side broke away.
Well done.
And Wilkinson's pass to Hipkiss. George Shooter there. The French try and repel the English like so many times before in history. It's there for Richards. He takes the tackle of Sarzeski. It's simple stuff from the men in white, but it's solid.
Use that, the ball is out.
The ball out to Lalio, backs into the defence. This time Michalak
hold there.
Plays the jackal, but he can't wrest possession back for the boys in blue. Wilkinson waiting out to the right.
I think he's setting up for field goal.
And as Ben Chun mentioned, the kick off the left. It's high and it's handsome. Wilkinson again.
One thing it may now give the French is an opportunity back down the other end. They've got 2 minutes to score.
Nice boot. What a great strike. I'm just amazed by how quickly he can get that drop kick away. Look, catch, reposition the ball, drop it and kick.
The practice, after practice, after practice. The French have it now. They need to score a try. A penalty or a drop goal is no good for them. Out through the backs it flies and David Marti. Elisaud, is there a hero in blue? Sarzeski hammered at the advantage line. Elisaud to Michalak. Vincent Clerc back inside. He's so dangerous, Vincent Clerc. Elisaud has his hands on it. Michalak. Oh, the pass was a floater and Dominici had a look.
It was a terrible pass from Michalak. I know that's left to right, but we're talking about a world-class number 10. You should be able to fire that left to right and right to left like a bullet.
Just didn't seem like he set the ball properly in his hands, and as it flew away from him, he realised he'd lost the ability to hit his target well, but it was a pie.
So that could quite possibly be curtains for the French. There is less than 60 seconds to go, and this is an English scrum.
Three big mistakes. Krzyzewski, Shabal, Michalak, Gilden.
Stay down! The sides!
Peter Richards and Toby Flood this time. The big right boot finds touch. It will give the French another opportunity with possession. Ibanez and Serge Betson. The heartbreak of 2003, they can only look on helplessly. Sarzeski with this, quite possibly the final play. Dusautoir and Elisaud, Michalak, the pass back on the angle. David Marti. a penalty to the French.
On the side, not on your feet.
3 points is no good to them, though. They play on quickly. LSL, Aragoniki. This will be it unless the French can score. Back inside, Josillon, Frédéric Michelac. The brilliance of Michelac is required here for his side. To the left they go again. RT to Tion. Sheridan tried to get his hands on it. Alassane to Josillon. That's little Dominici, the French. They need some inspiration. Out to the right once again, Michelac. Is this the space they're after? Vincent Clerc burrows his way infield to keep the ball in play. It's the final throw of the dice for the French. Michelac, that pass was flat. Would be a brave referee to call it forward, though. LSL to the right, Michelac. Josillon takes it forward, offloads. It's the eighth phase for the French. Make it nine.
Michelac has to start take that.
That is time. The English. It's back-to-back Rugby World Cup finals for them. And they make history in that respect. The French, they cannot believe it as Sweet Low Sweet Chariot sounds out around Stade de France. The boot of Johnny Wilkinson once again has done the job for England.
Ben Garwin mentioned it, three mistakes. Big occasion, lots of pressure, has an amazing impact on individuals. Three silly mistakes, Szczecin just being lazy in the tackle. Chabal lost his cool.
Michelac's last pass.
And then Michelac.
Well, the difference was 5 points. And it may well have been the 5 points of Josh Lucy in the opening minutes of the match. Wilkinson congratulates and commiserates with his French opponents. Chabal, like so many of his countrymen, if not all of them, absolutely gutted.
Brilliant.
The English, beaten 36-0 by the South Africans only a few weeks ago. Beat the Wallabies. Now they beat the French. They go through to the Rugby World Cup final. They will take on the winner of South Africa and Argentina. That tomorrow. For now, we'll be back in a moment on Network 2.
Well, how many times has Johnny Wilkinson had to console somebody on the ground after a major Rugby World Cup game? I sense quite a few times, and Sebastian Chabal's prone figure says it all. And the English fans will be jammed into those metro trains tonight, and we'll be jammed in amongst them on the way home.
I don't think they'll go
Maybe
back.
Maybe they'll be on the streets.
I don't think they'll go back for the working week next week either. I think they'll just probably
stay here
and ride that wave of momentum. Singing the gambler for Kenny Rogers and Matt Stevens. They threw the dice and they come up trumps.
Well, the funny thing is Nicolas Sarkozy has been right behind this French team ever since he sensed that there were votes in it. But Gordon Brown, the British Prime Minister, is a Scot. So he's been in strife in Parliament. He doesn't know which way to go. His team's out, so he can't ride the bandwagon. Anyway, it's going to be a very interesting week, and we will follow it conclusively for you. In the meantime, South Africa is playing Argentina in the next semi-final. Can the Argies keep it going? People are saying their run has ended. Well, who knows? They said that about England, didn't they? Stade de France, 4 a.m. Check your guides for details and don't forget the replays. We'll be back with more from this astonishing Rugby World Cup on behalf of Ben and Rupert. Bye for now.
the 2007 Rugby World Cup.